It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood, a neighborly day for beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day.
The short of it is, he said, if you show the geometry of this here, nobody will probably be talking to you. But if you start showing the mathematics here, don't be surprised if someone would like to talk with you.
Okay, guys, welcome back to the Grimerica Show. We're going to be chatting with a friend of the show, Edward Nightingale, a little bit later. We met him at Paradigm, had a good old time with Ed. But first, as always, Greedy Graham, how's it going, buddy? See what happens when you make me do it on the fly?
Greedy? Greedy. Yeah. Really? That's like Greedy. The farthest away from me, I would hope. I think you've said that one before, too.
Probably.
Yeah. I was thinking like gallivanting would have been a good one.
Maybe. Greasley Graham.
How about glamorous?
No.
Glamorous. Your co-host, Glamorous, glam.
Graham.
Glamorous Graham Dunlop.
And I'd like to introduce also Red Pill Junkie, the infamous 4TN blogger and soon-to-be podcast specialist.
Aficionado.
How are you, Red?
Hey, man. How's it going? You know, how's the weather up there?
Beauty today, plus 11 or something.
Yeah, it was nice and warm.
Yeah, well, I just want to know, you know, what the hell happened with winter? Because right now it's you wouldn't believe how fucking warm it's here down here in Mexico. I mean, it feels like we're already in April or May.
Yeah, say here it seems like it could be spring. Yeah, this close to the mountains, you never get too excited because that can change in a fucking instant. We could be buried under 2 feet of snow again, but it seems like spring. But I was actually talking to an older fella about it and.
An older fella?
Yeah, from work.
Oh, yeah?
And I was like, fucking weird, eh? And he was like, no. He's like, when I moved here in 77 or 78 or whatever, he's like, I didn't even have to buy a shovel for 3 years. I just had a broom. So?
Yeah. So what are you saying? That it's getting colder?
It's not
colder, that
global warming.
Oh, that it's not global warming. Yeah. Yeah, plus Austin, we were just talking to our guest tonight, and Austin was hit the freezing mark, right? And back east, there's a big deep freeze going on back east.
Well, even in RPJ's post, he says it was below freezing or he was cold. I still picture that as it's like 10 degrees, and I'd be down there in a t-shirt and fucking board shorts.
But like Bill Nye the Science Guy says, or Bill Nye the Climate Guy, can't you just mention that it's climate change?
Well, there is this post at the NASA.gov, you know, webpage, you know, NASA satellite sees a warm winter U.S. West, you know, mentioning how, you know, even despite the fact that in places like Boston and up north, you know, New York, there is still, you know, under tons of snow, on the west side of the United States, you know, even New Mexico, and also in my country, Mexico, you know, they're experiencing the opposite, you know. In LA, you know, they're really, you know, having one of the warmest winters ever.
Yeah.
I welcome it.
Well, you wouldn't welcome it, you know, if you were, you know, in LA, in the middle, stuck in traffic, you know, scorching to death, you know, on the highway in your car, and maybe without air conditioning.
No, but I welcome the new weather in Calgary, because I don't have to worry about that for, fuck, it would take 150 years at least, more than that.
To get to that
before it's hot enough that Calgary's scorching.
Yeah, well, less people die during warming periods and cooling periods. We know that.
Do we?
That's what they say.
Well, who knows? Who knows? You know, I was reading that in places like Sao Paulo, for example. You know, it's the biggest city in the Americas. You know, 20 million inhabitants. I actually don't know if it's bigger than Mexico City. But anyway, they are suffering from a terrible drought. You know, I mean. That it's reaching, you know, alarming levels. You know, people are actually starting to die out of a lack of water. And it's kind of, you know, amazing if you think that is it next year that Brazil is going to host the Olympic Games?
I think so. I don't know.
No, I don't know. I think it's
so Summer Olympics. So, yeah, that'd be the year. 2016 yeah, summer and 2018's winter.
Yeah. So imagine if they still are suffering from a lack of water in Brazil, you know, just in the middle of the Olympic Games, you know.
I don't know. They'll find a solution.
Well, hopefully.
For the Olympians and the attendees anyway.
Yeah,
I don't know about the Brazilians.
For the Olympians. Yeah, for the Olympians and all the tourists who can afford, you know, a $20 bottle of water, you know. But what about the people living in the favelas?
Four hours ago, Brazilian president pledges total commitment to Olympic Games in 2016.
Wow. I heard that we've got...
I seen a special on Brazil the other day. They had to have those fucking trolley cars. Or like fucking, you know, like the... They're like the ski lifts that you ride in.
Gondolas?
Gondolas coming down from the slums into the city. Just fucking nonstop because there's no room for roads.
Fuck, hey, that's a good idea.
Yeah, pretty sweet.
Why don't we put those up in Calgary so we can get people to the city? Apparently it's just a nightmare, the traffic.
That's been pretty bad.
Yeah, I think there were plans to build one of those here in Mexico too. You know, but it looked like, no pun intended, you know, a pie in the sky kind of...
So,
So much funner with my soundboard.
Darren surprising me with a jingle for the UFO quote of the week. So I guess we'll cut past some of the other crap and get into this.
Crap.
So, oh, and look at this. Cut through is the start of the quote. Cut through the ridicule and search for factual information in most of the skeptical commentary, and one is usually left with nothing. This is not surprising. After all, how can one rationally object to a call for scientific examination of evidence? Be skeptical of the skeptics. That's from Bernard Heisch, astrophysicist.
Yeah, the name does ring a bell.
Yeah, me too.
And there's, if you want a synchronicity for that, it's a zero.
So be skeptical of the skeptics.
Yeah, for sure.
So I felt bad.
Remain in the radical center.
That's right. That's what we're trying to do here in Grimerica. I felt like we skipped past Ed Nightingale, Darren. We should mention a little bit of him. His interview's coming up, talking about the Giza Plateau, right? And all the geometrical and mathematical precision that whole plateau was designed to, right? He's got a lot of good content, but it's real challenging getting it across on a radio show.
I bet.
Might be a good idea to go to the website while you listen.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
If you're not driving.
Yeah.
It was difficult to follow it, you know, back in the Paradigm Symposium, and while he was, you know, using his PowerPoint presentation, which was, by the way, you know, what the most sleekest, more professional looking slideshow, you know, presentation I've ever seen.
What kind of presentation did you say?
PowerPoint?
No, what did you say it was? You know? What did you say it was? It was very what?
Very professional looking, you know.
Right,
very,
yeah.
I know. Yeah. As a designer, I really appreciated, you know, the detail, you know, and you know, how, you know, beautiful and gorgeous his graphics were rendered on the screen. But even with that, it was difficult for me, you know, to follow his mathematical arguments.
Yeah. That's the point. Sometimes there's so much detail, it's hard to know what the profound elements are.
Mm-hmm. It's over your head.
Yeah. So
maybe
you guys...
he should use like music, something like that, you know, in order to present the mathematical points in a more instinctual, you know, more easy to grasp approach.
What do you mean by that? Playing music or using the musical tones as a metaphor for the math?
Maybe, you know, somehow translating, you know, the mathematics into tones, you know, musical tones. You know,
there is a musical overtone to this research, right? He talks about how the scales and everything are all interrelated.
Yeah, harmonics and all that, you know, it's all interrelated. It's all interconnected, you know, geometry, mathematics, music.
Speaking of that, Darren, aren't you starting your sacred geometry classes with Randall Carlson?
Yep. Me and my wife.
Really?
Yeah. We did class one.
Class one? How was it?
It was good.
Was it review for you?
Was it what?
Review for you? Like, you're pretty good at math, so was it, like, pretty basic, or?
Well, no, there wasn't really. We haven't got into the math yet. We just kind of got a rundown. We had to go out and buy some geometry kits.
Oh, yeah.
Some paper.
Protractors and
yeah.
Compass. Compass and square?
Compass and a ruler.
So you're using Masonic tools now?
No, all we're using is a compass and a ruler, and you can make all the other shapes.
Oh, cool.
Just by using, you use the circles, and then you make the other circles off the fucking outer edges of the circles.
Yeah.
Then from that, you can get the triangle first. It really shows you how much you could do with a piece of string if you knew how long it was. And like,
yeah, I know
that's
where
all
that
you needed.
Going.
Maybe a fucking stake to punch in the ground to do a circle, and that's all you need, man.
And a plank.
I can make all sorts of shit. Yeah, and a plank.
And a wood plank, and 3 hours of darkness.
In the dead of night, you know.
My newfound knowledge will come in quite handy.
I'm sure it will.
Yeah, that's good.
So yeah, that's. I'll keep focused, and we'll link in the show notes to where you can grab the classes yourself over at sacredgeometryinternational.com.
Yeah.
Of course, Randall Carlson is a friend of the show and an all time favorite. So me and the wife, we watched a couple documentaries, and we're like, oh, let's try and figure it out. So we're gonna go through the lessons.
Square that circle, buddy.
You get a couple phone calls with Randall too.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
So quick question. Is there enough content in that to do a normal segment for the next 8 weeks or whatever on the show?
I don't know about a full segment yet, but I'm really just scratching the surface. By the time I get to lesson four or five, then.
Okay.
Then for sure.
All right. Well, I might ask you about
I'll
it.
I'll know more. I'll keep you posted. I think we're going to try and do it in the format, like a lesson or two a week. So it's not just, you know. I think you learn more like that instead of hammering everything out. You know, I think they're about an hour and a half each. So if you could do them all in a couple of days, really. So there's eight or nine lessons. So there's probably 12 hours of content, which you could do on a weekend. But I don't think it would sink in as much if we do an hour and a half every week or 5 days or something like that.
Did you watch his YouTube series too?
I think I watched three of them so far. Okay. I'm just going to wait for the DVDs now.
Right. Okay.
Do I have anything that plays that?
I know. That's what
technology?
I was thinking too. I have to use my laptop to watch them now.
Do you still have a DVD player, Red?
Yeah, sure. I mean, well, not really. You know, my Blu-ray, which plays DVDs, and the DVDs. Installed in my old 4-year-old laptop.
Yeah, my PlayStation will play it probably.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good place.
That's the only thing I've got.
Really?
Play a DVD.
What about your laptop?
No.
No?
It's an error.
And that doesn't think that big fucking honking computer no, doesn't play in a DVD?
The DVD thing's broken.
Oh, really? So I got some feedback here. You want to get into that, or do you want to?
What sort of feedback? Where are we starting?
Well, I got some lucid dreams, some synchros, some feedback, some other stories.
Bring it on.
You don't say ham, you say spam. Spam, spam, spam.
That's the spam gram jingle. That's GRAHAM at Grimerica.com.
Graham.
So can I talk? Can I do a lucid dreaming one? We need a jingle for that. All right. This is from Aaron P.
There you go. No last names.
I haven't read this whole thing. I just know I've read some of it, and I know what's going to...
Hopefully it doesn't fucking get all fucking squirrely here.
All right, lucid dreaming has been something that often...
Because we all know Graham will read it verbatim, and he'll get about a paragraph into it before he even realizes it.
Lucid dreaming has been something that often happens for me, albeit irregularly. I suppose if I practiced at it, it would become easy. The lucid dreaming episode that we did there did help me identify my dream sign, and it was an aha moment when I realized my dream sign is the cave. It is a regular theme in my dreams. In my dreams, I find caves, or I'm in a cave always going in deeper for refuge or exploration. But that's not the dream I want to tell you about. Many years ago, when I was in a tough spot in my life, the point where I had rebounded from the bottom of the barrel, I had a slab of malachite that was 3 inches square by 1/4 inches thick. Now, he sent me a picture of this malachite, and it's kind of like a...
Malachite.
Malachite. Yeah, right. Sure enough. Thanks, sure. Red. And it's like when they cut the slab, it's almost like tree rings. It's kind of green, and it's kind of like tree rings and cloudy. Kind of thing, kind of trippy looking, almost like an ink blot.
You have the picture right there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Oh, I thought that was a brain.
Yeah, there you go, buddy. That's your brain on lucid dreaming.
Or nice. Magic mushrooms.
because this is interesting. I didn't know about this malachite. So we had a slab of about 3 inches.
Or even how to pronounce it.
Square by 1/4 inches thick. I don't know what had possessed me to put it under my pillow. I suppose I had wanted it to influence my dream state, and so it did. Malachite, for those who don't know, is a semi-precious stone that has different hues of green and sometimes a whitish swirl and rings. In my dream state, I was in the malachite. It was living, moving, and breathing with swirls and eddies. It should have been a peaceful thing, a peaceful feeling. There was, however, no peace. It felt wrong and totally uncomfortable. I was not accustomed to lucid dreaming, so it wasn't a fear of the dream state. There was something terrifying and wrong. I had to get out. Frantic, had to get out. Had to get out. I woke to find the malachite still under my pillow. I was holding the malachite slab in my hand and still overcome with the terror of the dream. I threw it against the wall, opposite the wall of the bed where it hit and fell behind the bookcase. I couldn't shake the feeling of wrongness, so I got up and went into the hallway that led to the other bedrooms and living room. I turned to the living room and found a creature standing in front of me about 4 feet tall, covered in hair. I guess it looked like a demonic chotka from the old school Land of the Lost. I probably pronounced that wrong too, eh, Red?
Chaka.
I don't know if I've seen the original. Chaka's Will Ferrell's little buddy in the new one. Chaka.
Oh, really? Chaka. It had claws on its hands and claws on its feet. I looked at it in its eyes, and it turned and ran. I could hear the claws tearing at the carpet, and as it ran and turned into the kitchen, claws clicking on the tile. As it ran away from me, I could also hear it breathing in heavy, wheezing rasps. I need help, I remember thinking. I walked into the bedroom where my grandparents were sleeping. They can't help me. They're sleeping. Realizing there was no help, I saw the crucifix on the wall that looked like it was back illuminated against the wall. I said aloud, help, help, help. And then I woke up cold and sweaty. That was fucked up. It had been 20-something odd years, and I still remember that dream like it happened last night. Now, here's a weird twist. I've never been a big fan of Conan O'Brien. Never really watched his show. I was flipping through the channels some nights later, and there was a midget in a monkey suit in the audience. or something. And Conan walks up to it and starts talking to it. It looked into the camera and it felt like I was looking at me. I'm pretty sure I was awake and not actually dreaming this. So somewhere out there in some archived Conan O'Brien footage is my personal demon caught on camera. Thanks for reading. I'm totally into your show, and I feel guilty about not kicking down to your show for as much as I enjoy listening to you guys. I did give you a review on iTunes today, so thumbs up.
Thank you very much, sir.
That's much appreciated.
What's Graham going to do with that information?
With what information?
This what I just read.
What are you going to do with it?
Buy some malachite.
Not malachite.
Malachite.
Maybe no. You should get both, just in case. And put it under your pillow?
Yeah, exactly.
Let me know how that goes for you.
I will. I still haven't bought that tea that other listener suggested, too. I keep meaning to look that up.
I remember when we were house-sitting, when we went back home for the social before we got married, someone was out of town, so we stayed at their house. She let us stay at her house, and she had lucid dreaming tea in the cupboard.
Yeah, I know. We talked about that, and you guys took it, didn't you? Or you drank it?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. But I think I was drinking too, or I was.
Yeah, passed out.
Yeah, I don't. Fucking nothing happened anyway.
Recently,
I don't remember.
I had blue lights in my room, and that actually stopped me from dreaming a little bit. So I changed them to red, and that actually helps. My dreams are more intense with red lights in the room. You should see the look on Darren's face right now, man. I'm just experimenting with different things, right? I got the old Christmas light thing, right? So I left it in there like while I was sleeping. And so I got it. Let's stick with that topic for a sec, because I got another one from Matt here. Is that okay, Darren?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah, want to play the lucid dream? Oh, we don't have a lucid dreaming jingle. So this is from Matt. very funny. I'm in the midst of this episode so far right now. So far, my favorite one, he says. I've had many lucid dreams. Unfortunately, I fucking hate typing stories on a phone. However, I did want to mention that I've done drugs several times in my dreams throughout the years and have experienced the effects, although not upon waking. I've taken mushrooms, LSD, and weed, and very similar to the states of consciousness those things induce, they tend to have a strange dream quality in their effect. Sometimes in the dream, I've taken them deliberately, and other times I've had the experience of ingesting them by accident, such as I'm talking to someone and automatically reach into a bag and munch a handful of caps, then think awkwardly afterwards, holy fuck, what did I just do?
Sometimes, I've been there.
Yeah. What, like in real life?
Yeah.
You should talk about that trip report you have.
The crazy one?
Yeah. Like the one that...
The three in the morning.
Yeah, the mother of all...
The one that quit the trips for
three in the morning at the witching hour.
Yeah, right around then. One day, not today.
Yeah, okay. One day, Darren will do his own personal trip report. Sometimes I would freak out about the upcoming trip and somehow manifest an antidote as felt myself starting to peak. Anyways, yeah, cool shit. If I didn't hate typing so much, you'd have a shitload of synchronicity stories, trip reports, and lucid dreams for us. So, guess you'll have to use our imagination.
Or you could use speak to dictate.
I talked to him about that.
Did you?
Yeah. You should check the voicemail too, man. He might leave us a voicemail.
I think there's a 30-second time limit.
So, speaking about this topic of dreaming and also the use of psychedelics and other substances, I wanted to ask you a question, Darren.
Fire away.
Okay, so this is something that was brought up in one of the Joe Rogan's podcasts, the idea that the regular use of cannabis, somehow ameliorates or diminishes the regularity of dreaming. Not that I am implying that you know anything about that, but, can you corroborate this?
Yes.
Okay.
I usually don't remember my dreams, if I dream at all.
Are you saying there's a correlation between chronic use and
But no, remember Dennis McKenna said that he thought it was that too, and then he did something and all of a sudden he was able to start remembering his dreams, so he said he didn't equate it to that.
Well, I don't know. In one of the psychedelic salons, you know, recordings, you know, he said that if he went cold turkey for a week or two, you know, then he will have, you know, the kind of dreams that will make you, you know, call your mom at 3 a.m.
I should try that.
Call your mom?
Cold turkey.
Yeah, well...
For a week and see how it goes.
Yeah, well, that will be an interesting experiment, you know. And you could report it back to us and the listeners.
Or not me, but a guy, know a guy who smokes weed.
Yeah,
exactly. You know.
So, well, speaking of psychedelics, then, Red, are you planning on partaking again? And I'm talking about your, I wanted to ask you about your blog. You wrote a small book. Yeah. You wrote a small book on your first experience.
You could ebook that shit.
Yeah, well, since I already knew that the alleged psychedelic experience, you know, that didn't have what some people call the quote unquote money shot. You know, at the end, what I intended to do instead was trying to do, in part, some kind of anthropological story, you know, trying to explain the particulars of the use of these substances among the Huichol people and how they go about their religious rituals, and on the second part, you know, narrated from a point of view that like some kind of a journey piece, you know, trying to make the reader, you know, go along for the ride with me, you know, experience the things that I experienced, you know. And that's why, you know, I soon realized I was, the thing was going to be way too long, so that's why I tried to do it as entertaining, you know, as I possibly could, you know. And when from the response I have received so far, you know, it's been, you know, mostly, you know, positive, and I think people did get a kick out of, you know, did appreciate what I intended to do. So getting back to your original question, whether I will do it or not, yeah, you know, I'm still considering, you know, considering it, trying to have it a second time, and maybe, you know, this one will do the trick. Although, you know, as I stated on that piece, you know, the alleged lack of results, I don't equate it as a failure in itself, you know, for the reasons that I explained on that lengthy essay.
That took you a couple months to put together.
2 months, 2 whole months, you know, from getting in and out, you know, getting in the zone, as it were, you know, writers will know what I'm talking about. And then, you know, leaving it aside because you have other things to do. And then, you know, you revisit it, you see what you wrote, and then you start rewriting it over and over again, you know. I mean, at least 10 rewrites I did with that thing.
That's why I stopped writing a long time ago. Once I figured out I could just yap, and there's no turning back.
Yeah, I know.
No rewrites.
I mean, I totally understand it. You know, for me, writing is still a grueling, you know, laborious process in which, you know, every single sentence is being brought out with the sweat and tears, you know. And, you know, it is by no means a fun undertaking, you know. I think some famous writers said, you know, that I don't enjoy writing, I enjoy having written, you know, and I totally understand that.
Is it getting easier now that your English is getting better? Because I noticed your writing is, and your reading is very, very good. Like your knowledge of the English language is almost like it's a first language for you when you're writing.
Yeah, it wasn't that way at the beginning. Of course, you know, people even criticized me on the Daily Grail, you know, something that I actually appreciated, you know, because it managed me to keep improving on it, you know, and you know, by now, some people are even amazed to find that actually I'm not a native, you know, English speaker, you know, that I was born in Mexico, from Mexican family, and I've lived here in Mexico all my life. I never had the chance to study abroad, something I would have probably enjoyed, but alas, I didn't have the chance, you know.
And you now know, we you make you talk English every couple of weeks.
Well, you know what? You want to know the real secret? You know, you want to know how I really started to get the hang of English?
When?
Movies. You want to know? No. I have three words for you, man. I think I've already mentioned this. Yeah, I've already mentioned this. But for the new listeners of the Grimerica show, I have three words for you.
The iTunes store?
Mr. Rogers Neighborhood. With Mr. Rogers. No, man. The man was a saint.
Maybe that's
I don't know what you're talking about. Don't you go about, you know, defaming Mr.
Defacing Mr. Rogers.
Yeah. How dare you, sir?
Is that the guy that would take off his sweater and his shoes when he got home every time and all that?
Yeah.
Won't
you be my neighbor? Well, the guy used to talk in such a pause, a slow and easy to pick up tone of English, you know. Easy to pick up for a known English native. That slowly I started to train my ears, as it were, you know. And sooner, by listening to him, I started to really get the hang of understanding English, you know, because before that, you know, it was really difficult, you know. It all sounds like gibberish, you know. You don't really, your brain is not able to parse the words among all that noise coming out of the people's mouths. You know what I mean? You know, I'm sure that the same thing has happened to you when you visit a foreign country, you know, like you, Darren, when you visited Mexico on your honeymoon, you know.
I always think I know. Once I get a couple of drinks, I think I know Spanish. Cerveza, cuivaro, baragi. They usually get pretty pissed off. I remember the first time I was in Mexico, I was down on the beach trying to talk to some locals, and buddy's like, yeah, you better just get out of here. Because I was like, I think I was trying to say, like, my Spanish is poor, but it was coming out as, like, Spanish people are poor. And... it was a train wreck.
And the worst is that I'm sure that a lot of people actually thought that you were, you know, last playing games, you know, that we're a Mexican playing as if it was a gringo.
Yeah, well, plus, I mean, I could pass for a Mexican.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You know, and we are all being a bit racist here, but well, whatever.
I could almost blend in anywhere in a pinch if I ever need to.
Yeah, sure.
Mm-hmm. I'm a chameleon.
Didn't Mr. Rogers have that little puppet thing with Henrietta or something like that? And do you remember that, Rat? Oh, that was creepy. There was some creepy kid shows when I was.
Just a little kid when Mr. Rogers.
He had a trolley, you know.
Oh, the trolley.
Coming in and out of his house.
Yeah, that was kind of creepy. And the mailman.
Okay, that's enough, no, Mr. Rogers. Okay. I didn't mean to cut you off there, Red.
Okay, hey, I got a synchronicity from Alan N.
Okay.
I didn't even know. I just kind of hoped.
And I want you guys to.
Mr. Rogers.
I want you guys to pay special attention to the very end of this because he's got a question and I want to know your take on it. So he's like, "Hello, Graham. While putting down pavers for a sidewalk, I had to cut a 2-inch thick root from a nice tree in the front yard.
Why didn't he just cut the paver?
What? Because he can't do that. Then the root just keeps growing through the pavers, right?
Oh.
I have no idea what I'm talking about. Before I cut it, I called my brother to tap his extensive knowledge on these kinds of things, and he said the tree will lose a limb on the opposite side. Tick for tack. After I made the cut, I walked around the trunk, and as I got to the opposite side, a 2-inch thick old limb fell off and missed my head by an inch.
Whoa.
That's pretty cool.
Is that a
synchronicity? His brother's up there, so I get down.
Is that the joke?
Yeah, that's it.
That's the end.
Fuck, man. Yeah, his brother told him a piece was going to fall off the other side of the tree, and he walked under it, and it did almost hit him in the head.
Mm.
Right after he cut the root?
Yeah, he says, after I made the cut, I walked around the trunk, and as I got to the opposite side, a 2-inch thick old limb fell and missed my head by an inch. I've never heard of that, actually, before. Like, if you cut one side of a tree, another side, like the yin and yang.
Let's go try it right now.
Yeah. Well, your wife almost had a branch fall off her, and
that was, yeah.
Were you cutting something on the other side of that?
No, there was a fucking tire swing hooked up to it.
I kind of surprised that you guys don't have any lumberjack friends, you know?
Lumberjack friends? Yeah.
I used to know a lumberjack.
Okay.
He's a tough
My grandfather was a lumberjack in the United States, actually.
Hmm.
Yeah. You know, he was a pretty strong guy. My father used to tell me how once, you know, was back in the job, and I think there was some kind of the logs, you know, like cut loose, you know, and there was some kind of like avalanche, you know, and somehow, you know, he managed to run and jump enough so that he could, you know, avoid being
crushed by a bunch of logs.
Crushed, exactly, yeah. So that speaks about, you know, his physical prowess back in the day.
Hmm. Alan's also got another one here.
That one kind of goes against itself. Because the higher the synchro, the less that's a real thing that happens. Because if that's a real thing that happens, then it's not really a synchro. It's just
it's not supposed to happen right away, is it?
I don't know. I'm not an authority on this. I'm authority in the synchro.
Well, we can leave that one.
That's a 6.5.
Oh, okay. All right. And he's got another one. He says, in my 50s, I'm in my 50s and I've never been stranded on the toilet.
Stranded?
Yeah. He says, great show. Have you ever sat there and wondered, why is Joe talking?
Joe Mama?
I don't know. What does that make you think of? What comes to mind?
Joe Rogan?
That's what I thought of. Why is Joe talking? Joe? No, I think he's talking about Joe Rogan. Why is he going on and on? Let the guest speak, maybe. I don't know. Could be my own
Joe
bias.
Biden?
So never being stranded on the toilet is not a synchronicity. It's a feat. But I've never been stranded on the toilet. I've had to walk out of a toilet, maybe not have proper fucking clean up.
I don't want to know about it.
You ever broken one? I was staying at a guy's place in Ireland and I shattered his toilet.
No.
Yeah.
Very embarrassing. It's like, well, thanks for letting me stay at your place. By the way, I broke your toilet in half.
Oh, my God.
Nice. What else you got, buddy?
Well, I got more stories if you want. And, you know, lots of feedback, too.
Pick something.
Let's get something.
Feedback.
Okay, let me pick a little feedback then.
Just pick a random one. Graham's a dick.
So, yeah, well, we got a message from Josh. He says, howdy, Graham. I tried to give you kids a donation through PayPal, but couldn't get it to work. The link provided, so Darren can talk about the fixing of this link.
I fixed it.
Yeah, sent me with a link with no direction to send you some cash. So I want to thank him for donating. He did finally make it work after Darren fixed it.
Yeah, and pointing out the fix button. I wonder how many people just give up when they click.
Yeah, I wonder how many donations we missed.
I wonder how long it was.
Probably not many.
Probably not many.
So a donation from my Measy account will not allow you to retire, but I appreciate your podcast and would like to give some value back. I found you through No Agenda and have been listening. He's been trying to pat people on the back. That's the Canadian equivalent of punching someone in the mouth.
I like it.
All the No Agenda listeners will get that. Like Darren, I'm still skeptical of several topics that you cover, but it's nice to have something to contemplate that I otherwise wouldn't consider. Plus, it pisses people off when you bring some of these things up, so that's another bonus. Keep up the good work, and I will continue to intake your content through my ear holes.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the support. Of course, that's how we keep the show, 100% ad and sponsor free, no ads on the website, because we are listener supported. You can find out how to do that at grimerica.ca/support.
Yeah, help cover the expenses.
Yeah, and get an email. Any subscription over $5 a month gets you a Grimerica email address while supplies last. I think at like 50 subscribers, we're doing Psilocybus 2.
Psilocybus 2, Enter the Mushroom, the sequel.
Again.
How many subscribers until there is an ayahuasca Grimerica show?
1,000. I got to get to Brazil.
You're going to regret that.
Do you want me to do another couple of stories here, or what? We got time?
The interview's long. Sure.
Okay, so these are some good stories here. This is from Todd R. He says, three stories, all very different. We were staying at a hotel in Montreal. I had sleep terrors as a kid and had always had pretty intense dreams. But I was dreaming about driving my car on a snowy highway and losing control and spinning out. I've had that dream multiple times. Mm. You probably haven't even had a dream of snow, Red, but it's this white stuff that falls in Canada.
Fuck if it snowed in Mexico.
Let me Google it. It was very vivid, and I woke up to the feeling of spinning out of control, very sweaty and shaken up. It took a while to fall back asleep. That day, we were driving home to Connecticut. Conditions are fine. We're partway into Vermont, and it starts to get really snowy.
Did they spin out?
Soon, there's a few inches of snow on the highway, and it's getting messy. I ask my wife if she had any weird dreams last night. She says no, and I don't mention anything. It would freak her out. I tell myself I'm not going to let it happen, and I'm going to get off the highway, get some gas so my Volvo has more weight. So we get off the highway and come to an icy hill. And sure enough, I lose control and spin a few times into a snowbank. No damage. We get some help and continue on our way. But it felt exactly like the dream I had had. I told her about it later that day, and she obviously said to let her know next time. I like those ripple stick dreams, those precognitive dreams.
Precog?
Well, I haven't had a dream of, you know, being in a car, spinning out of on a snowbank, but I have had dreams of being in a car, spinning out of control, you know? And I know there are people who say that you can't dream, have a dream of you in which you experience your death, but with me that's not the case. You know, I have had dreams in which, you know, I've reached this state in which I go in the part of the dream where I die, and that's when I wake up.
Wow. Mm.
Yeah.
Sometimes I dream that I'm falling, and I wake up, and I'm like, whoa, I'm not falling.
It's like, could that be any more cliche, Darren, really? Sometimes I dream of falling.
I get that whole vertigo sensation, though.
Yeah.
Did you go to the point where you reach the bottom?
No, most of the time I don't even know because I'm falling. I just wake up and I feel like I'm falling. I've got that vertigo feeling and I'm like in a panic, but then I'm in my bed.
Yeah.
And I just go back to sleep.
That's when I once dreamed
that I was somehow being killed by a firing squad. Like I was in some kind of jungle, and maybe I was some kind of guerrilla fighter or something, and my squadron or something was captured and we were going to be executed, and I remember waking up from that dream, sobbing like a baby, sad over my untimely death, and maybe some people will say, obviously this kind of dream was a reminiscence of a past life. Well, maybe, or maybe it was just something my fucking subconscious concocted, but it really had a powerful impact on me.
Hmm. It's that feeling afterwards that sticks with you for like half the day.
No, for me, it's half my life.
So I got a little trip report here, Darren, if you want to hear that. This is a good one.
Okay.
The same guy.
That should be the last.
Same guy. There's three stories on this. I want to read them all. Same guy. This is the trip report part.
Is this the third story?
Second story.
Okay.
One time my buddies and I did paper acid when we were about 20. We really started getting into it and we were booted from the small party we were at. They weren't cool with us dropping acid. So the three of us were driving carefully, trying to get to another safe place a few miles from where we are. Extremely rural, unlikely to see another car, but we see an identical Saab approaching us. We slow down, as do they, and we all look at ourselves as we pass. I'm thinking, what the fuck? But I'm afraid to say anything. Then my buddy says, what the fuck? That was us. We all saw it.
Ah. I've been there.
Really?
On TV.
Really?
Yeah, well, not in the same situation, but shared hallucination for sure. Big time with us.
Oh, on TV. Yeah.
They were all just tripping out. It wasn't themselves. That's a good one, though.
That's fascinating.
You think it was just a shared hallucination?
Yeah, I think there's like some sort of merger there. When you're tripping with a good group of guys and you're all in the zone, there's a connectedness.
I remember watching
stuff and everyone at the same time was like, whoa, did you see that? Yeah, Chin did that. And I was like, yeah.
And it totally wasn't happening. You all saw the same thing.
Yeah, definitely wasn't happening.
Yeah, I think I had some of those, but they were pretty minor.
And some of them were people I didn't even really know very well. Yeah.
What was that, Red?
Oh, really? No, I was just wondering about that, and Darren just answered it, I was wondering whether you can only have shared hallucinations with people you are very close to, but, Darren says it's not necessary.
No, I knew half of them really well and the other half not so well. I just met him like a few days ago before.
Me and my buddy, we used to like obviously trip out a little bit and yell and scream over things and stuff like that and have these sort of like mini trip synchronicity kind of things. So we're baked driving up this road and like the back roads of where we lived, right? Like similar to this actually. and we're driving up the road and we see this guy pass by us. We go, that looked like Jim Day. We both said it, right? Hey, that looked like Jim Day. The next car driving by, Jim Day was in it. And we both just lost it.
Who's Jim Day?
Just some guy. Older guy.
I don't get it.
You don't get it?
I get it.
Okay, last story. I have a twin sister, and we've always had a strong psychic connection to her. to her and others. My wife, deemed a genius as a young child, also has a strong psychic connections, and we often read each other's minds. Basic stuff like, you know, her calling me as I pick up the phone to dial her, or starting conversations about what she's thinking about, or vice versa. It happened many times throughout our relationship. It's just accepted at this point. We were maybe 22 years old and very early into our relationship. Had just boned and we were laying there chilling. I feel an amazing sensation. I start seeing stars everywhere in the dark room, reminding me of doing acid another time and being in my bedroom. Just shit floating everywhere, bright lights everywhere, but a very strong feeling and sensation to go with it. I'm debating about saying anything. I'm just enjoying it, but also feeling like she saw it too, but wasn't sure. Then said, "Do you feel that?" It was such an unusual feeling and unlike anything we'd experienced.
Both of them?
Yeah.
It's so, not just a flashback?
So peaceful. We just laid there for a while. It was the only time it ever happened, but we've mentioned it a few times to each other, saying, "What the fuck was that?" So they're both feeling the same sensation, similar to the shared hallucination, I think, that we just talked about.
Yeah, so, with a kind of tantric sex kind of vibe.
Jesus.
So thought it was worth sharing.
We should do a show about tantric sex.
Fuck yeah. I bought a book at Paradigm about it, the tantric one.
Yeah, sure, yeah. You did.
Okay, it was free.
You stole a book.
I thought it was worth sharing. I'm new to the podcast, but loving the info. Finally, others to share my beliefs. That's kind of a theme, too. I was drawn there because of Randall Carlson's podcast. After hearing him on Joe Rogan, I wanted more. He shared a ton on your show. David Matheson also blew my mind. I have such a strong urge to continue learning and expanding my mind. Keep it going.
A lot of new listeners. I like it.
Yeah, thanks, Todd. That was awesome. Love the stories.
I like to see Graham juggling feedback over there.
Yeah, Darren's liking my scrambling. Scrambling, Graham.
Yeah, well, you got anything else before we wrap it up, Red? We're probably going to be close to 3 hours on this sucker.
And it's getting late.
Yeah, well, maybe we should just wrap it up.
All righty. Well, that was a good conversation. Thanks.
Yeah, pick it up again next week.
All righty, then.
All right. So,
2 weeks till my birthday.
Oh, yeah? 34?
So no interview that week. 34.
Yeah. You're such a baby.
Are we taking the week off then? Totally? Or going to schedule something else?
Oh, we could do the day after or something. We'll figure it out.
So we got a lot of potential people booked for the show, but it's kind of all juggling in the air right now. It's kind of been a challenge, actually. March. So there's lots of stuff happening. But we just haven't solidified a lot of dates yet. So we do have the mindfulness guy from Montreal or from Quebec. He's like a mindfulness expert, a Buddhism guy. So that's going to be fun. That'll be next week. Same time as tonight. Mm-hmm. So Tuesday.
Is that the right time this time?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there's a few other ones coming after that. We might have David Estelin back.
Daniel.
and a bunch of other guests coming up. So keep in tune to the backstage page on grimerica.ca, and you can find out how to get in the live chat room and to listen live and to go to the chat room if you want. And then we'll be releasing those episodes shortly after.
Yeah. Thanks for joining us, Red. And enjoy the chat with Ed Nightingale. I just felt like dancing, felt like dancing. We can sing together. I just felt like dancing.
just felt like dancing as I was sitting in my seat there.
Okay, guys, we're going to be talking with a friend of the show, Ed Nightingale. We met him at the Paradigm Symposium, had a blast. And we had a bit of a chat with him then, so most of you probably heard him. But we'll get into that a bit more. But how's it going, buddy? Excited for this one?
Yeah, man. Yeah, really excited. Yeah. Yeah, we've got, you guys, we chatted with Edward quite a bit at Paradigm Symposium. It was great. Mixing with some of the lecturers, and Ed's also presented at CPAC, the Conference on Precession and Ancient Knowledge, and he's been studying this stuff for like almost 20 years now, and he's got a background in master woodworking, musician, and he's an author and researcher, lives in Pennsylvania, and he's starting to do some radio shows now, because after he's presented his presentations visually in front of some people, he's gaining some interest here, and he's got this new book out called The Giza Template. It's Temple Graal, and I guess probably pronounced Grail, I'm not sure, and Earth Measure. We'll talk to Ed about that. And basically, it reveals that Giza was designed as a repository encoding high scientific knowledge while tracking the solar system as well. And he basically takes us through a step-by-step recreating of this complex in its entirety. And it's pretty mind-blowing. Darren and I have got the book here, and we've dipped into it, and we've seen some of this him present before. It's pretty mind-glowing. He presents a...
Mind-glowing?
Mind-glowing. Hand-blowing.
It's funny because you never call me, and I will never let you get away with it.
I know. Yeah, that's true. Anyways, he presents a geometric mathematical model of Giza that changes the game. In the words of John Anthony West, the architectural Rosetta Stone. So we're happy to finally have you on. Edward, thanks for staying up late for us, and welcome to Grimerica.
Great. Thanks for having me on, guys. Good to talk to you again.
Yeah, good to talk to you. Of course, we've seen your presentation at the Paradigm Symposium, and it was great there because we had the visual aids. And that's one thing your book is full of, is there's a lot of visual aids. So, I mean, if people are intrigued by this, I'd definitely pick up the book, and it really kind of walks you through it. But I guess we'll do the best to do it with our best to get through it without the visuals. So when did you first get into this, Ed? Like you kind of stumbled into this?
Well, I was always interested in Giza and, the mysteries like that. Probably back when Eric Van Doniken wrote Chariots of the Gods, I first started getting interested in the subject matter. And then being, a woodworker or a builder and a craftsman, the architectural structures of Giza just, really intrigued me as to why, they went to such lengths to and measures to build such structures, and why there were no hieroglyphs on them. And of course, at the time we were hearing they were, egotistical pharaohs trying to outdo each other, except each pyramid got smaller as they went. So that was kind of didn't really work as an explanation for me. Kind of insulted my intelligence. So I had the opportunity in 1997 to go on a trip with John Anthony West. And I was already, had been working on my theory, or it's not my theory, of course, but the theory that this was an architectural repository. And I kind of had an idea where the center of this complex might be. And went over there with John, and that really just changed my interest, because I did find what I thought I was looking for, the center, and I've been working on it ever since.
And that was like 97?
1997,
wow. Yeah. Yeah, that's a long stretch. So yeah. can you just give, just to sort of get people intrigued here, give us a quick summary of like what your book is about and what you're finding. Like basically you're finding a bunch of mathematical patterns, would you call it, in the whole Giza template, which is the plateau of the pyramids, basically?
Right. The plateau, the Giza plateau, that consists of, there's actually 11 pyramids and the Sphinx, and there's several causeways that connect to each pyramid. It's different structures on there. And what they did, these architects or architect who designed this, was to create a repository, and this repository would encode high science measure, the whole measuring system, that being the earth measure part of it in the title of the book. And if we get back to the title of the book there real quick, what this, the Giza template, they used a template to create this. So that's the template part. Now,
okay.
the word template, the origins of that word is temple, actually. So the temple Graal, what we're looking at is the word Graal actually can be read as a step or position or coordinate. So temple coordinates and earth measure is the subtitle to the book. So what they did, they encoded these numbers in these structures. That is really how all science is really based on these numbers, and nature uses these numbers. That's how we get the Fibonacci spirals that we see in nature, and all that. All that comes from mathematics and geometry. Now geometry. Is of course the beginning of it, and you can use geometry and then encode number in geometry using proportions of a circle or divided in half and divided up. So then you would be turning it into mathematics. So what they did there was encoded this knowledge, and I get a little bit. Toward the end of the book, I get into this with the Sphinx. Now, the Sphinx is actually really the calendar part, which the follow-up book to the Giza template that I'm working on now will show this whole connection to the stars and the movement of or trajectory of the solar system and the Earth in relationship to the celestial bodies.
Okay. So this isn't just I guess the I don't know, I don't want to play it like it's been dumbed down over the years, but do people just originally think they just sort of threw up these pyramids and there wasn't all this design incorporated in the plateau? Like obviously you found it all the way through the plateau, right? So somebody actually sat there and put a hell of a lot of science and math into the whole design, right?
Oh, absolutely. This is there's more to it, probably, I'm sure, than I even have found so far. But it's really irrefutable evidence that this was designed as a complete. It's a repository. That's exactly what it is. And they use these structures, the distances between them, the sizes of them, the angles of them, they all encode different parts of this knowledge.
Okay.
So then we're not talking about Egyptians. Like if we're going to this level, we're talking something pre-catastrophe, I guess.
I think we got to look at this.
Pre-something. Am I jumping something? Am I jumping some guns?
Well, we just jumped in the deep end there. Yeah. But let's go for it. We got to learn how to swim. Let's do it. So, if we look at what's been written about it or what we see written about the pyramids, there's not a whole lot. But what I have seen is there is a text or a hieroglyphs written in Edfu in Egypt, I believe, on one of the temples there. Mm-hmm. And it roughly translates to say something like the plans for the temples came down from the heavens at Saqqara in the days of Imhotep. Something like that. And that's really about all that's really been found regarding, where these pyramids, the plans, where they came from, where the idea came from, but the god Thoth, and if we look at Enoch, the biblical character of Enoch, I think those are I think they're two in the same characters, probably, but I think that's where we need to look.
Yeah, that's a whole other topic. So what are the Egyptologists?
I just started reading the book of Enoch.
Yeah, we bought it for the studio finally, yeah. So what do the Egyptologists think about this? Like, do they even pay attention to this, or how has this been received?
Well, from the Egyptologists, I don't know how they're going to accept this too well or not, but you know, if you hand them an equation of 2 + 2 = 4 and they frown at it, I mean, I guess that just tells a story. But what I've got here is, it's not theoretical. This is a blueprint. I drew this from scratch based on understanding what they were doing there.
Right.
So I don't know what the Egyptologists will say. I haven't got that exposure to them yet, I don't think. But
I mean, what this shows is that they were more sophisticated and intelligent in some ways than we give them credit for, right? So what do they think of? What do you think that they were going to think or about the difference in the culture of, you know, compared to what we think it was?
Well, you know, I think I'll probably get ignored a little bit, to be honest with you, by academia, but because they can't really refute it. This is something anyone can do. I've got it in the book. It's step by step, and it's really not that hard. And we're talking about the most difficult mathematics that's going on in there is really just basic arithmetic. You know, there is really not a lot of super high mathematics, or I mean, there is in deeper layers of it, but the basics is there. And you could really teach this to middle school children just to start off with.
Hmm. But it's still a surprise. Like, it's different than anything that we've thought of as far as like how this was designed, right? So I guess what I'm getting at is it's hard to explain how the culture back then had all this. Well, how they spent all this time and energy into designing it in this way. Like, it's pretty.
Yeah, well, yeah, let's get into that stuff later. Let's have that, because that's the fun. So let's.
Okay, what do you want to do? Get into the actual.
Well, yeah, let's get into the. Yeah, let's get into. So, what did you find? What did you find? And how did it originally jump out at you?
All right, well, to begin with, just from an artist's point of view, when I looked at Giza, I could see like a center, and the center of it, to me, the way it looked was at the causeway that runs from the center pyramid of Khafre down to the Sphinx. To me, that looked like the hand of a clock. And you know, of course, there were other causeways that went off the Great Pyramid and another one off the Pyramid of Menkaure, but that one in the center, just the way it was angled, it's about 13 and a half degrees off of due east. And, you know, again, to me, it looked like the center of a balanced complex. You know, it was about equidistant to the third pyramid, to the corner of the Great Pyramid. So that's where it started for me. And that's when I went over there with John. I was actually looking at that point and was kind of stunned to find about a 3-inch hole cut right in the bedrock, right in approximately the point that I was looking for a hole. And I, you know, I'd like to go back there again and actually check, because it was a little, you know, it was, we were on a tour and I had my video camera and I was trying to videotape everything and look and see. And of course I wasn't measuring or anything at the time, but so I found this point. And from then I knew that, you know, any kind of design, any architectural design, you would have to start with one point. And it hadn't been too far before that I was actually working on a house that was built on a radius. So this whole house, all the measurements were taken off one point. And this point was out in the middle of this circular driveway that was the center of the circle that this house was built on. So to me, like, that's how you would lay out a complex. You would pick one point to start your measure. So I got my compass out, and at the time then I was using the survey maps, and I was trying to understand it using the survey data. And after a little playing around with some circles there, I came to realize that the correct circle that seemed to work and capture each one of these structures kind of was if I had drawn a circle with a diameter that had 9 units in a diameter, and that one unit was equal to the base length of the center pyramid of Khafre. And once I did that, a few things started clicking together. So I worked on that for quite a while, and I had an idea, well, geez, if they're doing it like this, you know, I should see this and I should see that, but I was not quite seeing it. It was close, but not quite. And it was really kind of frustrating for a few years. And then in 2006, I came across a satellite image from the QuickBird satellite. And it was really a nicely centered image right over, directly over Giza. So I contacted satellite imaging and purchased the image, and actually got the data on the image, on the accuracy and all that. And once I got that image, then things really started to click, because when I worked with a satellite image, everything was logical and was falling right into place. But when I compared it to the satellite data, or the survey data that I had, the public data that was available, basically from William Flinders Petrie, there was discrepancies, and I just couldn't really, you know, justify that. Like, why are these discrepancies there? And at the time, I was talking with John West and even Robert Schock about this, and Robert had made a comment to me about the, the survey data, and I guess just in the conversation it came up that really no one else has been allowed to go in there and measure. So we were basically had information from Petrie that really wasn't scientifically verifiable. I mean, in any kind of scientific proof, you need to have someone be able to verify your data. And no one really has been able to go in there and survey and get precise measurements. We're all relying on either Petrie or Cole the most recent, I guess, survey was from the Giza Mapping Project, but it's not even available to the public. So I got to asking myself, you know, wait a minute now, you know, why would they want to, not be honest and open about these measurements? And then, of course, it really occurred to me, it was like, well, they're trying to hide something, you know, because using the satellite image, when all the pyramids were in their order according to a mathematical model, it agreed perfectly with the satellite data, but not with the survey data. And then I realized what was going on. They changed a couple of the numbers in the survey data to, not allow someone to figure this puzzle out.
Huh. So we're talking numbers like the circumference of the pyramids and that type of thing, or like basic measurements?
Yes. And really the basic measurements that were confused were the distances away from that center pyramid of the pyramid of Menkaure, the third smallest pyramid. That there was a 27-foot dimension difference in the survey data and the satellite data. And 27 feet, the number 27 happens to be a key number in all this. So that right there kind of tipped me off. And we're talking about accuracy that they state, the experts' quotes are in my book, that state that the survey image is accurate to within 10 inches. So, you know, we're talking 27 feet. And then there's also another discrepancy of, I think, around 9 feet between the distance away from the center pyramid of the Great Pyramid. I think there's actually might be two discrepancies there, but I haven't even bothered going back and looking too much further at the survey data because I know what I have here.
Yeah, well, I can just picture it. A couple guys out there probably don't want to be there, don't really care about the pyramids, you know. Out there with measuring tapes trying to pull it, you know, like who actually did the survey? Was it?
Well, William Flinders Petrie was a very accomplished surveyor, and there's no doubt that he could measure that to, with precision. It didn't have anything to do with the ability or the lack of ability to measure. I looked into Petrie and his family a little bit, and I think his father and his grandfather were both very high-ranking officers in, I think, the Scottish military, and basically set him up to be able to go do this. And they were interested in occult subjects, matters as well. So I think Petrie knew exactly what he was doing there. And now whether it was Petrie who actually gave the numbers incorrectly, or whether, you know, the government said, no, these are the numbers you're given, someone that understood exactly what I have here, told them or made the decision not to let these numbers out to the public. This is just like a big Rubik's Cube of numbers instead of colors. When everything is in its proper place, all of a sudden there's just magical numbers that relate to one another incredibly beautifully are revealed. But if you change one number in there, if we change the distance between one pyramid to the other, all of a sudden everything falls apart. And nothing really works out. These numbers don't have these relationships.
So how did you reconcile all the differences in surveys and the satellite? Could you get an accurate number just from the satellite pictures? Like, can you focus in enough to measure some of that yourself?
Yes, and we were able to zoom in to get into, you know, pixels. And it was a very high def image to begin with. And again, we were able to measure to within 10 inches. Now, what I did with that satellite image is I used AutoCAD, a computer-aided drafting tool, and actually physically drew a full-scale model of the Giza Plateau based on a mathematical model. I don't know, you know, how much time you had to spend with the book, but the distances between these pyramids are key numbers in that were obtained from a mathematical coordinate system. If you saw the 8x8 square in the book, there's numbers generated from that coordinate system that give us the sizes of each one of these pyramids and also the distances between them. So I was able to really just, within a short period of time, was able to figure out what they were doing. It was made to be decoded. This is a very, it's beyond brilliant. I mean, I can't even, sometimes I just get so overwhelmed when I look at this thing. It just really blows me away. But it's made in such a way that a simple compass and a square and basic mathematics, you can recreate this thing from scratch and then and literally understand what it, what they're doing. So, you know, it was just it was beautifully laid out so that one could easily decipher it with basic tools and basic arithmetic knowledge.
So okay, let's get to the meat here then. So what were they up to?
Well, again, they were encoding this knowledge of mathematics, high science, the science, you know, vibration and frequency, and the actual measure of the earth. And beyond that, in this follow-up book, I'll show how that the Sphinx connects the earth to the sky. In the builder's trade or whatever, we have what's called a witness mark. Now, you put a witness mark to align two pieces that you put together. When you put two pieces together up, you like make a line across the two. So when you put the two pieces together, you can see that they align.
Yeah.
So what the Sphinx is doing is the witness mark to the constellation of Leo in the sky, the lion in the sky and the lion on the ground. That's the key to this whole thing right there. And when you line those up, then you can start measuring. Think of if you had the job of an architect or an engineer, and they're creating this repository, they say, okay, we've got to show and map the trajectory of our Earth's solar system and how it's moving through space, because this is all important in this great cycle of time where we have periodic events, catastrophic or what have you. So think about that. The first thing that you would have to do is, of course, as the architect designing it, you would have to have one point on Earth which you just would sit and watch and measure the sky from. Okay, and once you made that alignment, you did that with Leo, you created alignment on the ground. Now you're going to go and watch the stars. And these stars are going to be on the ecliptic, in other words, on the plane of the solar system, that how the planets revolve around the sun. That's the ecliptic, that plane, if you will. They were the star of Regulus that's in Leo is right on that ecliptic. So they picked that star to be on the ecliptic to mark out that we're measuring the ecliptic and from the ecliptic. And
that was aligned years ago, right? Like like before the pyramids or something, wasn't it? Or
Well, I've been working on that. This second book coming out hopefully soon. I'm going to present this whole reconciliation of the calendars, the calendar system. It's all there, perfectly encoded in the stars and on the ground. But I've confirmed for certain, absolute certainty, that back to 3114 BC, you know, everything was stable. You know, there hadn't been any pole shifts or anything like that. And the reason I say that is because the alignments that happen at these different times, they wouldn't line up if things had changed between now and then. So we can trace back and look back using like Stellarium software or some kind of star program. You can actually look from a certain point and watch the sky back through time or forward in time, whatever. And I'm certain that the 3114 BC date, I also have a really intriguing date that really works right in line with Robert Bouval's Orion correlation theory of 10,500 BC. I'm kind of leaning toward that quite heavily. I'm still working on some other dates in antiquity, But there is another date that I found a really intriguing alignment that I don't know quite how to fit this in the puzzle, but the coincidence is far beyond being a coincidence. But I have a date of 25,920 years B.C. Huh. That seems to be a really good alignment for the constellation of Leo, huh. Which is, you know, it's hard to ignore that.
That's the one, you know, great year, right?
Right. And coming off the year zero in the Gregorian calendar is quite interesting. Huh. But if we want to follow up on that a little bit, just how this calendar is actually reconciled is from the year 2012, December 21st, 2012. Huh. That was the biggest alignment that would happen in a 25,920-year period, the alignment with the galactic center that the Mayans, you know, the big hubbub there in 2012 with the Mayan calendar. That was the end of a 5,127-year cycle.
And the start of Grimerica, right, Darren?
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
You guys been around a while, day. I know.
On that day, Darren, the website started, yeah. So.
All right, great.
So we're starting the next great year, Darren.
Yeah. All right. Cool.
See if we can last a full procession.
Perfect, man. That's what these guys
were
doing.
That's a lot of interviews.
Just what you guys were doing there. You were lining up things, man. That's great. But anyhow, that was where these calendars all get reconciled from that date. From there back, I can reconcile the Gregorian calendar, the Mayan calendar, and the Hebrew calendar. And they're all right there at Giza. And matter of fact, in the third pyramid, smallest of the three, the pyramid of Menkaure, it's a rectangular base to the pyramid, and it actually has two slope angles, one being 51.84 degrees and one being 51.27 degrees. Now, I just mentioned that the Mayan calendar was 5,127 years. Well, what they were doing is they were using degrees and years. They kind of work together. So the 51.27 degrees is you just take the decimal point out of that and you got the 5,127 years of the cycle beginning in 3114 BC. And then the 3114 BC number is actually quite interesting because that also is an angle that's encoded too, 31.14 degrees. So it's all really fascinating. I hope to get this book out soon. And but the first book here is basically the foundation to everything, the ground measure and the temple coordinates, if you want to call it that. And the next book will build on that.
So do they point to anything like? I guess I just wanted to sort of walk through exactly what's in the numbers, I guess, at the plateau, in the complex. Or
okay, well, we'll take it from the Great Pyramid. The Great Pyramid encodes a lot of different things, and there's a very simple equation to come to the base length of the Great Pyramid, and if you look in the graph. In the book, and you will see that the number 432 is a really well-known number in sacred geometry and numerology. But 432 is like the sound of the Om, and also
frequency.
Right, that frequency, and it was also used as a tuning frequency for an A432 note that was really used by Stradivarius actually used that that frequency to tune and create his violins. And Verdi composed in 432 tunings, and that was very popular back in early days. But anyhow, this number 432 is in there. If we take 432 and we multiply it by 21, we get 9,072. 9,072 is how many inches the base length of the Great Pyramid is.
And where does the 21 come from?
The 21 comes from, if you look on the 8x8 the 8x8 grid, the coordinate grid, it is the 21st interval up the up a scale that goes up diagonally up across this grid. And it actually creates a fifth interval scale, just like in music. I don't know if you guys are musicians or the musicians out there will know that a fifth interval is the fifth note of a major scale of seven notes, or the eighth being the octave. And this number 432 is a 21st interval up. So using those two numbers, we just created the base length for the Great Pyramid. So now we're going to do the base length for the center pyramid is very simple, and we're going to take 432 and we're going to subtract 21. That gives us 411. Now, the base length of the center pyramid is 411 royal cubits. So right there we got the base length to the second pyramid. And the third pyramid, it took me a little while to figure that one out. But what they were doing there is they were using seven cubed. In other words, seven multiplied by 7 multiplied by 7 equals 343. So the base length on the one side of that pyramid is 343 feet. Now, this scale in which we find all this in, if we look on our 8x8 square, what we have is a doubling set of numbers going down the left side. It starts at 1 at the corner, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, and 256 down the side. Across the top, it's 1, 3, 9, 27, 81, 243, 729, 2187, and 65, 61. Now that is going by threes. So we're doubling down the side and tripling across the top. That gives us the numbers within that coordinate. We can go anywhere down, you know, like let's pick another number here. 27 times 32 would be 864, or 16 times 27 is 432. So 16 down and 27 across, we're at 432. And so this scale that we're picking this out of is 7 down and 7 across, and that would give us 7 intervals up the angle. So we got 3 7s there, 7 down, 7 across, and 7 diagonally. So there would be the 3 7s that we're using to get the base length for the third pyramid. So in a very short order, we can determine the base lengths of all three of these main pyramids using very simple numbers and measure.
Now, aren't those base lengths also correlated with the circumference of the Earth too, or something like that?
The Great Pyramid, yes, has relationships to the Earth measure, no doubt. And it even gets a lot more detailed than that. What's interesting, okay, we determined that 432 multiplied by 21 is 9,072. And if we assign that the inch, so it's 9,072 inches, that comes to 756 feet. It's also, if we take, let's see, we're getting to the measuring system into the root cubits. I don't know how much you went over that, but in our diagonal scale that goes up, the, let's see, get to the right page here. Okay, it is the scale that goes up diagonally starts at 128, goes to 192, to 288, to 432. Now, between the 288 and the 432, which is the 21st interval, there's 144 intervals in between 288 and 432, right? If we subtract 430 or 288 from 432, we have 144. We talked about the number 144. If we divide 144 by 7, we get 20.571428. That number is the root cubit. And within our Great Pyramid, the base length is not only 9,072 inches, it is also 441 root cubits. And then it gets a little bit more involved where we take a root cubit and we make a royal cubit from the root cubit. And the base length of the Great Pyramid in royal cubits is 440 royal cubits, which is pretty well, that's what Petrie came to the conclusion that the base length of the Great Pyramid was 440 royal cubits. But they don't explain where these cubits come from. They only got them by measuring and finding, well, that must have been the unit of measure. And but I'm here within this chart, I show you precisely where all the cubits come from, where the inches come from, the feet, the mile, the yard. It's all perfectly
laid out
in this beautiful little template.
Yeah, so yeah, I want to make sure the listeners know too, like this, it's really hard to make this visual, but your book, almost every page is a diagram, and it's got, you know, analysis of all the structures on the template, and it's got, you know, when you look at the template itself, it's, you've got the center line there with all the circles and showing how everything's lined up, and the Fibonacci sequence is in there, and I mean it's all very visual, so it's hard to describe the, you know, the relevance of it, eh, Darren?
Yeah, and I was gonna get into like feet and inches and yard, like who are we talking about? It was Randall Carlson, I think, who kind of let us in on how, you know, there's a little bit more to those measurement systems than just, you know, somebody's foot length.
Yeah.
Oh yes, absolutely. Yeah, Randall Carlson, he's a great guy. We had a great time out in Paradigm. I met him out there, and we've been in touch a little bit since then. And he's a rock star, that guy. He's got some serious stuff going on.
Yeah, no kidding. It's good, cool watching you guys collaborate there at the symposium. So let's get into that sacred stuff a little bit. So you mentioned 432 is in there, and it's all over your measurements here. And that equals, I guess it's one of the reasons why it's sacred, is it's that 432 equals 9, right? It seemed like everything that Randall was talking about was somehow equaling 9.
And I want to just let you know too, if you look at that 8x8 grid there, the coordinate grid, and if you were to write in each number at each one of those coordinate points on that grid, what you'll find, and then you sum those numbers, just like, you know, you guys are doing there, summing the numbers. I think it goes the first two columns down, the 2, 4, 8, 16, et cetera, and the next column down, I think those alternate of threes and sixes, they alternate. And then every number in the coordinate system after that, beyond those first two columns, all sum to 9. every one of them.
Yeah. Huh.
So, yes, that's why it's the combination of the doubling and the tripling together that create these beautiful numbers and that all sum to nine and are all sacred numbers. I mean, I think all the sacred numbers that you could probably name are in this coordinate grid here. And that's where they all came from, this science. And it's understanding how these two work together, the doubling and the tripling. It's kind of like the, you know, I don't want to get religious here or anything, but the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. That's what they're talking about. It's a doubling, a tripling, all coming into the one.
Huh.
It's a really beautiful thing that once it's understood, it's Tesla knew all about this. Tesla said, if you want to understand the secrets of the universe, you need to understand the threes, sixes, and nines. That was a rough quote there, but he was saying that. And, you know, I think Einstein understood a little bit of this too, and Nikola Tesla surely did. And another one who knew this was Edward Leedskalnin of Coral Castle. He knew exactly this grid that we're looking at here. He understood that. That's how he said he understood how the Egyptians moved the stone and cut the stone, and he knew the secrets of the Egyptians, and this is what he knew. This is what he understood. Hmm. And I've actually been to Coral Castle, and I've measured Coral Castle.
Huh.
And I can show you that Ed Leedskalnin used all the numbers that we've just been talking about, all these numbers. For instance, on his front door, it says Earth 21. Okay, 21 is the number that is the key in all the division that we do here. And it even gets into the constellation, 21 degrees above the horizon, etc. And also, 21 is really the only hieroglyph ever discovered in the Great Pyramid, and that would have been in the southern shaft of the Queen's Pyramid, or the Queen's Chamber, that they sent the Upawat little machine up there. Gatenbrink first did it. He sent that up, and they found a doorway.
Mm-hmm.
And then I guess they sent another team in there to drill a hole through the door, found another door beyond that. But within that little chamber there, they found some hieroglyphs in there. And the hieroglyphs in there, it was quoted by Zahi Hawass that said that the number 21 was the main number. The other number was 121, which is 11 squared. And 11 is a huge part of this whole puzzle as well.
Yeah, we just did a couple episodes on Coral Castle if people want to go back. And we had Scott Russell on who thinks he's figured how they were actually made. It's pretty cool stuff, actually. Yeah. And we had Joe Bullard on, too, who talked about, wrote that book about Ed Leedskalnin, so...
Well, one thing interesting that no one really has recognized about Ed Leedskalnin, and this was one thing that went back early on when I was thinking about this. I was thinking, okay, if I am correct in this assumption that Giza is this repository and they were using these architectural structures to encode certain numbers, who else would have known that? Well, right away, Coral Castle came to mind because here was a man that claimed he knew how the Egyptians built and constructed the pyramids or whatever, and, you know, put his money where his mouth was. I mean, the dude built an amazing place there, and no one could really figure out how he did it. But they were all, you know, big stone structures. So my thought was, well, if Ed Leedskalnin found the same thing I found at Giza, he would have encoded these numbers in his structure. So I took a trip with my family, actually went down to Coral Castle for a few days, and talked to the wonderful people there. They were kind enough to let me do a little measuring. And immediately, I mean immediately, I started measuring and was stunned. I mean, I didn't even have to really measure. I could count blocks and actually see that he was using these same numbers.
So just to keep, I don't know how to describe this to people that are skeptical of, like, because you know how people, when they hear, like,
yes,
sacred geometry, when they hear numbers, you've probably heard it a lot. Yep. It's like, oh, you're just putting numbers together and making stuff up. But if I was to plan out some architecture like that and make it aesthetically pleasing and functional and all that and plotted it out, the chances of it, you know, meeting all these principles are pretty slim to none, right?
Exactly. Like, the, you know what? You got to be. I wrote this kind of in the beginning of the book. You know, for all the people out there that say, oh, you're just playing with numbers. And right. Randall Carlson hit the nail on the head. He says, yeah, I'm playing with numbers. And so did God. And I'm having a good time doing it. You know, and the chances of any of this being, you know, a coincidence, you got to be a coincidence theorist. Okay. It's beyond, you know, I've got hundreds and hundreds of measurements here that all work in beautiful synchronistic simplicity and mathematical precision that, you know, I don't need to defend this book. This book I can put down on the table, and I challenge, and I'm doing that right now, any academic or someone from academia or a skeptic or whatever, I challenge you, read the book and you might have a different opinion of it. You can't really refute this stuff. It's a, you know, if I drew a blueprint of, a cathedral somewhere and I did it from scratch and all the measurements came out perfect, you know, with the built cathedral, you'd have a hard time saying that, you know, it was a coincidence that I was able to draw this thing perfectly.
The real mystery here is well, I mean, it's not really a mystery, I guess, but hey, Darren, you measure shit like this. You're a bit of a builder too in your day job. And the mystery is thousands of years ago, whoever built this, it's got to be at least 5,000, maybe more. It's pretty phenomenal that they had all this science back then. Like, we have calculators and all this shit now. They must have been doing it with some pretty rudimentary tools, eh? You'd think, Darren?
I think it's just older than that. It's
really? Like, you think it's
Atlantean
older than that?
Yeah.
Oh, like you think
Atlantean
it's going way
remnants,
back?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Atlantis being a civilization, not a
that
place.
That was more like more technologically advanced than the Egyptians,
think? Yeah, like maybe more than us. And they seen this shit coming and there's nowhere to go. Like, what would we do if we seen a rock coming at us? There's nowhere to go. There's nothing to do. We just got about, maybe, I don't think we're even advanced enough that we would think about the future.
And they were, they said they encoded all this stuff.
Yeah, they took the time and thought about the future generations.
Yeah, well, if you read the book of Enoch and see what Enoch was brought to the heaven by God or whatever, and was shown, he names these different architects and astronomers and mathematicians that taught him all the sciences, and he was told to go back and create a repository so that these this knowledge would be saved in the event of a cataclysmic event. And that's pretty much how I see it. Now, and getting back to the dating on this thing, I've got a thought on how all this kind of ties together. Okay, Robert Schock dated, you know, with John West, they dated the Sphinx to be, you know, very old. They're talking possibly 10,500 BC or so, which would, come into play with Robert Bouval's Orion Kerr relation theory.
Yeah.
But also, what's really interesting to me, and even from a builder or an engineer point, is very logical, and it really kind of helps this along. There's a lot of argument, when the Great Pyramid, when was it built, you know? Well, I suggest that the layout of this complex was the foundations of this complex, were all done about the same period. If you look at the
center map? Okay.
Right. Well, if you look at the center point of the satellite map there, where this causeway that runs down to the Sphinx begins, that temple that's in, they call it Khafre's mortuary temple, but that temple actually is 360 feet long by 144 feet wide. Okay, those two numbers right there are pretty amazing. But also, those blocks that temple was built from are limestone blocks, huge limestone blocks, very similar to the ones that are set out in front of the Sphinx in a Sphinx and Valley temple. And Robert Schock believes that temple probably dates back from when the Sphinx was built.
Ah, okay.
So also the base of the Great Pyramid, the lower courses being larger blocks, and as well the Pyramid of Khafre, the center pyramid. And also the largest block, I think at Giza, limestone block, is in the temple that's up by the Pyramid of Menkaure, the third or smallest pyramid. I think it's close to a 200-ton block up there. And that all shows the same type of erosion and antiquity associated with the Sphinx. Okay. So now, if we look at that from a builder's point of view, that's what you would do. And think about this. We're talking about an architectural or a construction project that would take generations to do. So you would think, well, what happens if we run out of, funding or help or whatever to build this? What do we do? Well, the way this is designed, about 90%, maybe not 90, but a large percentage of this puzzle can be pieced together just with the plan view or the footprint of each one of the pyramids and the lengths. So even if the pyramids didn't get completed and you had enough, enough of an open mind, you could probably figure out a good part of this, even if the pyramidal structures themselves weren't totally completed.
So are you talking also about when you look at the satellite map there, right? Darren, you see the satellite map up there. So the middle pyramid has like two layers of this big block around the base of it, right? And it's it's quite wide, right?
Yes.
And it's quite profound on that whole satellite image. You can see it, and it steps down below the smaller pyramid. Mm-hmm. So is that taken into equation too, like the measurements of that actual base that it sits on?
Yes. Yeah.
Because I haven't really noticed how big those bases are. Like, they look like massive square platforms that
the footing.
I think what you're seeing there, what you're looking at, is you're looking at this plateau was not completely level. It up by the third pyramid, the smallest one, which would be the western portion, it's actually higher than, and it drops off downwards toward the Sphinx. So what they were doing there, they were cutting in the bedrock and leveling out big areas for where these pyramids would be placed. So they cut into the bedrock on the plateau. So what you're seeing there is like walls that are, you know, if you were leveling out a piece of ground that had a slope to it, it would be pretty much level with the ground on one end and cut down in, you know, several feet or whatever in the back. You understand what I mean?
Yeah.
So what you're seeing there is some walls and different levels where this plateau was leveled and prepared for these pyramids to be placed.
Huh. Have you had a chance to look at Göbekli Tepe or anything like that? Because they're saying that's you know, kind of old like yes. Sphinx.
Yeah, I've looked at it a little bit and kind of working with it with Laird a little bit. Laird Scranton, he helped me write this book, and I got to really give him a big thanks. He really helped me. I'm not a writer by any stretch of the means, and he really helped me put this book together. And along with his linguistics, it actually all tied in. And I just want to note, too, that when I first met Laird, one of the first things that I saw him speaking, and he talked about in his linguistics finding what they called a light cubit or light measure. Mm. And I was just blown away. I said, wow, he's looking at what I'm looking at here. You know, he's talking about what I'm looking at. So that's how Laird and I kind of got together there. But
yeah, Laird's a great guy, too. We've had him on. He's starting to get into some real deep research with the UK and his next book coming out. I don't know if it's out yet or not, but yeah, looking forward to that.
So basically, I guess we're just – it turns out that it's – basically, it's like a place to hide the same sort of sacred numbers that you're talking about in sacred geometry.
Yes, and what I got to say,
lesson.
Yes, what I got to say here too is that what's encoded at Giza really ties into most all other architectural structures that are there. At one portion of it or another, it's basically the same information encoded. You know, the information in the pyramids in Mexico. And
a couple different, you know what, I almost look at it as each pyramid's in a different form of measurement just in case, you know, which only one of them fucking survived.
Right. And like Laird talks about, there were these teachers. And I mean, that's literally what these ancient cultures talk about, is there were great teachers that came and helped build civilization after a great catastrophe, and they taught people this knowledge. Now, just like, you know, when you're going to school, you have different teachers. Well, each teacher might teach something slightly in a different way, but it's still all the same information. And that's what we're seeing at these different structures, Stonehenge and all of them. I'm really excited, and I encourage other researchers especially to just read this book. And it's not about me in a book. This is about sharing really important knowledge here. And with this, I think this was the grand, Giza template was, or the Giza plateau was the main lesson, I guess, in stone there. And it was that same information was put in different places. I think that's, what's going on in Göbekli Tepe, too. Just like Laird talks about, he sees that in all these different cultures, there was, teachers that were teaching these basic civilization plans and these ground plans. And what's really interesting, this template is based on a circle of nine and a square of eight. and most all ancient cultures use that as their basic land management way to that they were taught to lay out their civic centers and their land was using this 8-9 square, which we'll just get into the geometry of that a little bit. If you have a circle with a diameter of 9 and you want to estimate the approximate the area of that circle, a very simple way to do that is you take 8 of those 9 units of the diameter and you square them, so you have an 8x8 square. And that 8x8 square would equal 64 square inches. And the actual, if you do the math on the circle would be 63.6428. So it's very close approximation.
So then, like, say a 10-inch circle, you'd use a 9 square?
Well, a 10-inch, if you had a 10-inch circle, what you would want to do is just divide it into 9 units. It just equally divide that circle.
So then you'd get an 81.
Well, it's not quite. Well, it would change. You'd have to do the math on it. But you would take that 10-inch circle and throw out the 10 inches. That doesn't matter. But just divide it up into 9. So you'd have, you know, like one. You'd have squares of 1 point. You know, 1 inches or something. But don't do that. Just whatever the size of the circle is, you just divide it by 9. And then you take 8 of those units and you square it, and that approximates the area of that circle. So then you could measure the square once you're done and say, okay, my square is, 9 inches or whatever. So 9 times 9 is 81. Yeah, so you're about right what you were saying there.
Okay.
See, it's
you know what's funny when you look at that picture. If you slide that up, it almost looks like that thing they say for the different, the second dimension or the third dimension dimensions. Never mind.
What are you going on? No, but I think it's a way that you can measure the area of that.
Oh yeah, I get it. Yeah, that's why I got 81.
Yeah. Okay.
You just
multiplied 9 by 9.
Yeah, well, but I subtracted one.
We were approximating there, so that was good enough. You got the point, definitely.
So you were talking earlier.
I don't have to show my work.
We'll check it here. We'll grade it.
Yeah, you were talking a little conspiratorial earlier about how the old surveys of the pyramid plateau, the Giza plateau, were different than what you see on satellite now. But there was one in your book there on page 62. You talked about the Petri triangulation plan and how that agrees with QuickBird. So is that because that's so deep into the research that they didn't bother fucking around with those numbers?
Well, that's interesting. Let me touch on that a little bit. Yeah, you were talking about how we would compare the template mathematical model with the satellite, and it was matching precisely, but it didn't match with the Petrie survey numbers that he gave.
Right.
But Petrie also drew a triangulation plan. Now, as far as I've been able to find, I can only find one copy of this actual drawing. But what's very interesting about that, as you noted there, is that, his drawing happens to match the satellite plans and the mathematical model. So, you know, when Petrie drew his drawings, he knew exactly what was there.
Right.
But now, okay, in a drawing, we can see that they match, right? But when you give the numbers, when you look at his...
basic numbers, kind of.
Right, the numbers, the triangulation numbers that he gives, you really can't, you can't see that. You're just taking his word for it that that's the number, you know? So, yeah, you know, when you lay the triangulation plan that Petrie drew himself, it's a copy of it. So that's all I had to work with, and I'd really like to see the original. But, they agree with the QuickBird and the mathematical model, the template. and they disagree with his own measurements. So explain that one to me, folks out there. That,
you know, that would be a pretty pretty crazy coincidence, right?
Yeah, yeah. Sorry to bring names into this.
No, yeah, but, yeah, that's okay. He's probably been mentioned before on here.
I think so, probably, yeah.
There's been a few shows on Egypt and all that. It's pretty mind-blowing. Yeah, I wish that, you know, the listeners could see the visuals of this.
I know.
It's pretty crazy.
Maybe a difficult thing to talk about on a radio, but, you know, just really get the book. I wrote this as in as much of a layman's terms as I possibly could, and it's filled with, I think every page has at least almost half a page of graphics on it. So I try to, you know, walk you through it and, explain it step by step. And you can all see it. And, you know, the chances of, Petrie having his measurements disagree with his drawings. I mean, I think that Petrie probably left that drawing out there to say, yeah, you know, for anybody who's really looking hard enough, you'll see that this is correct. Huh. And you know what's really interesting, too?
Well, at the time, there was no threat in it, right? There was nothing to compare it to. Who would foresee that there'd be a fucking satellite image in 100 years that was going to call your bluff that you fudged a couple of numbers?
Right. And that didn't happen really, you know, until, I found the satellite image here. But let me just reassure you that there are people who know exactly what this is about. I am certainly not the first guy to find this out, but I'm maybe the first guy that's bringing it to the public's attention.
In that level of detail. In that level of detail, yeah.
Well, I guess going public, I feel actually a lot better than I did while I was working on this.
I'll have to
tell you.
Huh.
And actually that I'll let you guys in on a little bit here too, that, my very first public presentation of this material was at CPAC in 2000, it was 2006. I went out there. Actually, just a poster presentation. I didn't really speak, but, Walter had me, do a poster presentation. So I got out there, and they had an article, a local newspaper here, Pocono Record, did an article on my discovery, and it actually got quite a bit of attention, and I was there presenting the first morning at CPAC, and I noticed this gentleman that was just standing there, pretty much stood there the whole time in the morning, was just watching me. He didn't come up and talk to me. He just kind of stood there. And we broke for lunch, and I was going to go have lunch with John West and some other guys. And this guy approached me and said, "Oh, Mr. Nightingale, would you mind, could I have lunch and buy you lunch, and I'd like to talk with you a little bit." And I said, "Well, you know, I appreciate the offer, but I kind of want to talk to these folks over here and that I came with." And he goes, "Well," he says, I came a long way to see you." He says, I took a red eye from Langley, Virginia. I'd like to talk to you. Yeah. And then the hair in the back of my neck stood up a little bit, and he looked at me. He says, I really like to talk with you." He says, "I came here to see you." And I said, "Well, how did you even know about me?" He says, "Well, I read the newspapers." He says, "And I read your article, and I figured I better come see you." So I said, "Okay." So we sat down and talked, and he was actually a really cool guy. And he proceeded to tell me some things, and I guess without giving away a lot of the detail of the conversation, making this too long, the short of it is, he said, "If you show the geometry of this here, nobody will probably be talking to you, but if you start showing the mathematics here, don't be surprised if someone would like to talk with you." And so...
Well, don't hold back here because we got lots of time, and
I know,
and I know, we have all the time in the world for MIB CIA encounters with our guests. So,
so well, anyhow, you know, to cut it to the short here, he just basically told me, he said that there are people that would like to see this knowledge come out into the public, but there are also others that don't want to see this out in the public. He said he was there not to discourage me, but to encourage me, but to also, in case I wasn't aware of the fact, he wanted to make me aware that, you know, we're talking about some serious high science here that there that is known about in the tier one science. You know, we're tier two, tier three level out here in the university level and below. We don't have the science, the way it's being taught, it's just a lot of propaganda. Some of it is just absolutely absurd. Some of the what they're teaching at the university level. And not all of it, and I don't mean to offend good teachers out there and people in academia, but there's a level of science that's being suppressed, and you know, that's the bottom line, and it's at Giza.
Do you think it's gonna bust out anytime soon?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's on the verge right now. You guys like Randall Carlson and Graham Hancock and a lot of other people, Laird Scranton, everybody's kind of coming to the same conclusion and rapidly. You know, I think this piece of the puzzle I present here is going to be a big piece of the puzzle. And I'd like to encourage other researchers to get this and look at this. This, again, isn't theoretical. It's all really basic arithmetic and basic geometry. And look at it. It's going to change a lot.
Yeah, and I guess this really spurred you on too, because that was quite a few years ago when that happened. And
yeah,
since then you've kind of
a
little bit.
Well, I've been kind of laying low for a while, I'll be honest. But well, actually, back then, what was going on is I knew I had something. And, you know, I'd wondered what I should do with it. And I was advised by some different people. They said, just put it out there, even if you don't have the whole story, get it out there. And I did actually, I think it was 2008. I was actually, I had a book. It was a precursor to this one that I was working on, almost finished, and was on Graham Hancock's site as author of the month. But what I was doing then was just showing how I back engineered it. But boy, I was getting chewed up like I was jumped in a lake of piranhas, because I didn't have all my I's dotted and my T's crossed, and there was a lot of unanswered questions. So it was actually a really good thing for me to have people, you know, really jump on it and tear it up, because that forced my hand. And I said, okay, I just got to wait till I figure it all out before I present it again. So I just went back to the drawing board, literally the drawing board, and spent many hours trying to understand how this puzzle goes together. And I've got it here. And, you know, I challenge in a most, you know, humble and kind manner anyone to look at it, and believe me too, if somebody can point something out here that I have wrong, or is you know, I don't claim to have all the answers here, and I'm sure there's more information encoded in here than I have come to. You know, I certainly that's why I want other researchers to look at this. But I've kind of feel like the boy who cried wolf. You know, there's been 10,000 theories on, you know, the pyramids, and, you know, it's hard to stand out when you've got, you know, so many other people claiming, oh, we figured this out, we figured that out. And I'm standing here telling you I can actually recreate this from scratch. And everybody just kind of looks and says, oh, yeah, another pyramid guy. You know, it's,
it's
a little frustrating. But I think now it's starting to get a little bit of a leg. People are looking at it and actually saying, whoa, you know, hey, this isn't some kind of crackpot theory here. This is precise.
How's the reception been so far?
Really, over the top excellent, I got to say. On Amazon, I got a 5-star review so far. And the reviews only, the few that are there, are I couldn't have paid people to write anything nicer and more. I really appreciate it for those who have reviewed it. And anyone that does, that's out there listening, that's either read the book or is going to read the book, please do that. Please give an honest review on Amazon there and let people know what you think. And I think that'll show. And I am not afraid, you know, of any negative whatever you think of it when you read it, give me a review, you know.
That's good.
I'm looking for the truth here. I'm not looking to be, you know, this is not about me. I can't emphasize that enough. This is about what these ancestors left for us and the importance of what's going on here. Now, while we're kind of on that note here a little bit, one of the reasons I've been a little bit persistent trying to especially talk to other researchers about this, and maybe they almost kind of wonder, you know, what's this guy? Leave me alone, you know, he's bothering me. But I got to tell you, the calendar part of this, as I said before, the date where the calendar reconciles was 2012, December 21st, 2012, at 12 hours, 21 minutes, and 21 seconds, to be precise. That was when this calendar all points to. So what I'm telling everybody here is, hey, we don't have another 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 years to kick this thing around, man. We need to look at it like now. And I mean that very sincerely. And I, you know, I hope I can get people's attention here, because it's really important.
What about your own personal experiences? Sometimes we talk to our guests about like synchronicities, or it seems like there's a common thread or theme that a lot of the researchers or authors we talk to have had profound synchronicities or experiences that have propelled them on their path. It sounds like, you know, you're talking about some of that in a way. People interested in your subject for sure. But is there anything else that you have to share personally like that?
Wow. Yeah. It is pretty personal too, but, I guess I'll share this with you and, the rest of the folks, I guess. I'll tell you what really happened was, you know, I was woodworking and had a nice, client list, had my own business and was, doing okay. And, playing music in my band on the weekends and running my business during the week and enjoying life. And my daughter passed away at 16 years of age in 1996.
Oh, sorry to hear that.
And, well, thank you. And that really just shocked me. And my parents were retired and they were living on the West Coast. So I didn't really have them around, and you know, I had my friends and stuff, but so I was really kind of looking for some kind of, you know, support there. So, you know, I got to thinking about religion, and you know, I was brought up as a Christian, but I went to church when I was a young kid, and that was about it. And then I never really went and paid too much attention to it as I got older. But I started, you know, to really ask some deep questions, man, when that happened. And so I figured I needed this to look into religions, because I said, well, what makes me think that I was taught right? We got all these religions out there, and what makes me think that mine's the right one? Because the other guy's saying his is the right one. So that really got me into looking into religions. So I just delved into the books and read and read and read on different religions, and what stunned me really to find after a lot of research was that at the core of all these religions were these numbers, you know, the Trinity, and you know, just a lot of numbers and geometry and the sacred geometry. You know, I started realizing that the different religious symbols had similarities in their design and what they were, you know, why did they use these specific designs and where did they all come from? So I thought to myself, well, if I'm going to research this and really look into this, the place that I need to start with is Egypt in the pyramids. That, you know, is where, you know, the three major religions really were born out of, is Egypt. Huh. So, and of course, I was already interested from a builder's point of view of the pyramids. So I looked around, and it was just kind of a unbelievable synchronicity, I guess you call it, that I saw that John West was given tours in Egypt. So I called him and asked, you know, if he was going to be doing any more trips. And he said, well, we won't be doing a trip. We just finished our trip this year, but we'll probably be doing one next year in November. So I said, yeah, sign me up. Let me know. And so it's close to a year. And he contacted me and said that when he had his trip scheduled. And so it was, I guess that was probably the first great synchronicity there that happened, because what ended up the trip that when we went over to Egypt, when I got there, and actually the first day that we looked at the Sphinx, it was a really great way he presented it too. We came in the middle of the night into Cairo, and it was all dark, and we got our hotel in the Mena house right near the plateau. And he told us not to open our blinds in the room, and we were to get up really early in the morning, and we were to meet out at the bus, which we did. And they drove us to a point where we could view the Sphinx, but we couldn't look at it until he told us to turn and look, you know. Yeah. And so that was kind of how we looked at the Sphinx. But the synchronistic part of that was that would have been my daughter's 17th birthday.
Oh, wow.
And that really kind of blew me away that, you know, I had no idea when this trip was to be taken. But, you know, I just ended up there on that day. The first thing I saw looking at the Sphinx, and I was very emotional moment for me, I got to tell you.
Oh, of course, yeah.
And so I made a promise that day right there. At that point, I made a promise that I was going to search for the truth, and I was going to figure this out, and I was going to understand this, and I was going to figure out why these religions all had a common core. And that's the promise I made, and that was in 1997. And we're here today. So that was just the first of many God, I can't tell you how many little synchronistic things happen to be along the way here. I mean, I could go on all night about that.
Well, that's a fairly powerful one. Yeah, that's. So, did you guys plan on watching the sunrise that morning then?
Yeah. It was sunrise. Sunrise when it happened, and you know, it was just awesome. I mean, and I'll tell you something too. You want to go see Egypt? Take a trip with John. And it'll change your world.
Yeah.
He's been doing it for so long. He's such a great guy.
Yeah.
So
definitely on the bucket list.
Sign up with John, man. Go with John. He'll take on a hell of a show. I knew it was a great thing when we were on the bus. It was actually him and I were the only two Americans. The rest were mostly British and some South African people and. A few from the Netherlands, I think, but he started doing the Cheech and Chong routine, and I was able to. We're going back and forth with Cheech and Chong. I knew right then he was the guy for me to take on that trip.
I did the Cheech and Chong routine on the Great Pyramid in 1990. Actually, fall of 1990. Yeah, smoked a doobie on the
Great Pyramid. Oh, yeah?
Yeah,
that was good.
I didn't even know what a doobie was.
Yeah, I was going to say, were you 10 years old then, Graham, or what?
Oh, no, I was like 20, 20.
Okay, you were a young pup.
Yeah, I turned 20 that year. Yeah, that was an amazing trip for me, too. A month up and down Egypt, it was crazy. Yeah, mind-blowing.
Yeah, we had 2 weeks over there, and we went up, you know, down to Karnak. No, we didn't get down that far, but we went to... I think down to Luxor and
probably.
We didn't go that far either.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Anyhow,
yeah,
that's good. It was great. It was just a great, great trip.
Yeah. One of the freakiest things was the Valley of the Kings. There's all these caves on the wall up in the, and you, on the
yeah.
right where all the priests were buried. And I went in there with my flip flops on my thongs. Did I tell you this story? And I broke. Yeah. I jumped down and there's all these bones scattered everywhere. And there's little kids asking for backsheesh. And I broke one of my thongs jumping into the cave and had to walk out of there in scraps of rags and bones from the mummies in my bare foot. Yeah, it was weird.
Jeez, he has some peroxide on that, man.
Yeah. Yeah, that was good.
So do you have where can the listeners track you down? Do you have a website and stuff like that?
I do. I'm working on it a little bit right at the moment, and I'm hoping to get it back up and going here right shortly, but it's the GizaTemplate.com.
Okay.
And they can reach me there. I do have a Facebook page, but I got to admit, I don't spend a lot of time on Facebook. But
okay.
I know I got to try to use it a little bit more and reach a few people. But
we'll link to all that in the show notes. And then what's the best way for people to buy your book?
Amazon.com.
Okay.
That's pretty much the best place to get it right now. It's right. I'm self-publishing, so I don't have a publisher, but... that's the easiest place to get it, and it's there. And like I said, if anyone who reads this, I'd appreciate a review. Give me a little feedback and let me know what you think.
Right on, we'll do. And we'll link to everything in the show notes.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Is there anything else that you want to say before we wrap it up?
I guess we'll see you in October, too.
Yeah. I'm really excited. I want to mention that, too. Yeah, we're going to be back speaking at the Paradigm Symposium. Scotty Roberts and John Ward invited me back, and Randall Carlson's going to be there, which what a great guy he is, and he's got so much important information, so it should be a great time. I know I really enjoyed meeting you two guys, and we had a good time there, and I really look forward to this next year.
Well, thanks a bunch for coming on the show, Ed, and thanks for the books. I can't wait to get into it a little bit more. I kind of went through it quick. It seems like you really got to, you know, you could almost donate, 10 minutes to a page.
Yeah. You want to read it. And I've had a lot of people say they've read it two or three times. But, boy, you know, it's only 81 pages long and half of it's graphic. So it's not a ton of reading. And I've really tried to, explain everything as...
Dumb it down.
Right. Well, I'm no genius either. I'm just a woodworker that just made a promise and here it is. So
I like how you made it 8.5 by 11 too. So it's not a tiny little book. It's got big pages that are easy to
Right, right.
All the graphics are pretty easy to read. So.
Yeah, that was my intention. You know, I wanted to make it so that people could see these graphics because this is the important part of this.
Right, yeah, graphics. Exactly.
So when can we look forward to the next one?
Well, I'll tell you, I was hoping in a couple of months here. I got all the graphics done and the research part of it done, and I started to write. It's going to be about the same size as this book here, the first book. So I'm hoping in a couple of months, I'm really working hard on it, trying to finish it up.
Because this is really,
look at the first book here, read that first book. That's going to give you all the basic foundation or the fundamental knowledge that will make this next book be like, oh, wow.
Perfect.
And, it'll explain a whole lot of things.
Well, I can't wait to see you in Minnesota again this year, and we can do this in person.
Likewise, dude. That was fun. I appreciate our little time at Paradigm there, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, absolutely. That's what we're here for.
That's right.
All right, buddy. Thanks for coming on.
Hey, man. Thanks for having me, guys, and I can't wait to talk to you guys again.
All right. Take care, Ed. Now, welcome back to the Grimerica Show. That was our chat with Edward Nightingale.
Yeah, that was it's kind of a hard one to follow. Hopefully you guys stuck with it.
Yeah, he's got a shitload of good information in there. It's just
the book's a lot easier to follow.
Articulating it.
Yeah, I hope he can smooth out his presentation because the book is a lot easier to follow. There's tons of diagrams, and I definitely recommend it's definitely worth picking up.
Yeah. Yeah. Put it this way. The
he's plateau, onto something there.
Totally. The plateau is following a bunch of fucking crazy geometrical principles.
It'll be interesting to see how much him and Randall talk this paradigm in October. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's good stuff. So we want to thank Edward for coming on. And
yeah, friend of the show, Ed. Come back anytime.
Yeah.
Who's next? Next release will be shit.
Would it be Connor Habib? No.
Yeah, Connor Habib.
That quick?
I don't know. I could be wrong.
Could be wrong. Yeah, we got to get this shit together before we do the little outro. But
that's all right. It'll be a surprise then.
It'll be a surprise then, yeah.
Surprise, motherfucker.
So help support the show for sure.
Yeah, grimerica.ca/support. Help keep us ad and sponsor free.
Yeah.
And that's about it, I think. Yes. So sign up for the newsletter, grimerica.ca/news.
Yeah, leave a voicemail if you want.
Grimerica.ca.
You can check out the show notes for a list of all this stuff and links to everything that you can do to help us. Review us on iTunes is a big one.
Yeah, and of course, the easiest thing to do is just pat people on the back. Tell people about the show.
Yeah. Thanks a lot for listening.
And it starts, what do you do with the man that you feed? When you feel so mad you could bite. When the whole wide world seems oh so wrong, and nothing you do seems very right. What do you do with the man that you feed? Do you punch a bag? Do you pound some clay or some dough? Do you round up friends for a game of tag? See how fast you go. What do you do with the man that you feed? What do you do with the man that you feed? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do with the man that you feed? What do you do with the man that you feed? And that first line came straight from a child. I work with children. What do you do? It's great to be able to stop when you've planned a thing that's wrong and be able to do something else instead and think this song. I can stop when I want to, and stop when I wish, can stop anytime. And what a good feeling to feel like this, and know that the feeling is really mine. Know that there's something deep inside that helps us become what we can. For a girl can be someday a lady, and a boy can be someday a man. What do you do with the mad that you feed when you feel so mad you could bite it? When the whole wide world seems oh so wrong, and nothing you do seems very right. What do you do with the mad that you feed? Do you punch a bag? Do you pound some clay or some dough? Do you round up friends for a game of tag? Or see how fast you go? When the whole wide world seems oh so wrong, and nothing you do seems very right. What do you do? Do you punch a bag? Do you pound some clay or some dough? Do you round up friends for a game of tag? Or see how fast you go? You've made this day a special day by just your being you. There's no person in the whole world like you, and I like you just the way you are. And I feel that if we in public television can only make it clear that feelings are mentionable and manageable, we will have done a great service for mental health. And that first line came straight from a child. I work with children.